Hello, everyone, and welcome to a new episode of CEO Talks, where we interview top executives representing different sectors and industries to discuss the implications, challenges, and even opportunities COVID-19 has created. Our guest today has been a leader in the wellness and hygiene industry and a manufacturer of hygienic products for over six decades. The group sells its wide range of products in more than 80 countries around the world and is considered to be a market leader in this industry. Here to talk about the company's operations and the impact of Corona on the industry is Mr. James Michael Lafferty, CEO of Fine Hygienic Holding. Hi, sir. How are you? And thank you so much for being with us on CNBC today.
Thank you for having me, May.
So, James, everyone, I think, now wants to know how were the company's operations impacted by COVID-19? To what extent in the first half of this year did you witness or did you have to change the strategies and the planning that you were doing due to COVID-19?
Well, we obviously made significant changes to strategy, and we had significant impacts, both good and bad. Borders were closed. There was restrictions on worker movement. There was difficulties in getting supply chain and deliveries from around the world on a global business. So we took some impacts. But on the other hand, because we're a wellness company, because we sell sterilized products and we focus on sterilization and sanitization, there was also an increased demand for our products in this pandemic time. So we lost some business. We had many increases in costs and many issues that hit our business. But on the other hand, our benefits became more relevant to consumers.
Yes, this is what I want to ask about. So which products, are there any certain products or sectors that you have witnessed an increase in the demand over them due to COVID-19, especially that during these 6 months, we have been focusing so much as consumers on the hygiene and wellness and sanitization and all of these aspects.
Right. Our core business was tissue, and we have the only tissues in the world that we sterilize. Now, prior to COVID, people would say, that's nice, but I'll look at other things as well. Suddenly, in a COVID situation, when you think about where you touch tissues, you touch your eyes, your nose, your mouth, other parts of the body, which are entry points of germs, people start to think it's a good idea to have sterilized tissues. And suddenly, we found ourselves selling more tissues and even exporting. Right now, we export from our Egyptian plant to the United States. We had never done that, but there was a demand for sterilized tissues. On top of that, we had moved into self-sterilizing textiles like masks and gloves, and we were working on all that before COVID came, and we just accelerated the launch.
You were working on that even prior to COVID-19?
Yeah, we were for about 2 years because there's a wonderful technology out of Switzerland that we had discovered and met with that actually the fabric will kill the germ. It's quite amazing technology. And we were working with them, and we wanted to apply it to the paper, but it wasn't working very well. But it works perfectly when you put it on the textile fabric. So a mask, a reusable mask, or gloves, reusable gloves, or even garments for doctors.
Okay.
It continuously kills the germs. If a germ lands on it, it is killed in a safe and non-toxic way. So once we saw that COVID may go global, we accelerated plans to bring masks and gloves into the market. So that's why we were quite early in the game.
So are you the only company that relies on this technology, or you have competitors when it comes to this specific technology?
This specific technology, we have the licensing agreement for all of the Middle East and North Africa. And then on some product categories, we have, you know, we're able to sell globally.
Okay, so in light of using this technology, have you, I don't know, made some new partnerships with the hospitals in the region, with specific industries that are in need of such products?
Absolutely. We've already had a strong established medical business with our tissues because they're sterile. So it's important in a hospital setting to use sterilized tissues. We already had strong relationships. It's only become more solidified as we've brought masks, gloves, and other sterilized items into the medical setting.
So let me go back one step and talk about the composition of the portfolio of products that the company has. To what extent did you alter this composition, this portfolio of products to fit with the new circumstances around COVID-19. Have you launched any other products other than these masks, or are you planning to launch any new products because of COVID-19?
We are a company of three pillars. We have our tissue business, which is sterilized. We have our diaper business, which is for babies and adults. Mm-hmm. And then the third is what has been established, which is our FineGuard line, which is a line of disinfection products. It started with masks. We just launched gloves a couple weeks ago. We launched kids' masks today. Mm-hmm. We launched sports masks last week. And we'll be coming with hand sanitizer and surface sanitizers in the next months, which the difference is if I use my hand sanitizer, okay, it sanitizes continuously for 24 hours. Wow. So you only have to put it on once. Mm-hmm. So think about from the kid's standpoint, the child's going to school, you worry, are they going to keep using the hand sanitizer I give them? If they put this sanitizer on in the morning, all the way to the next day, no germs on their hands.
And these launches are also covered in the MENA region. So they're not only internationally, they are also focused in the MENA region.
This is our home. These are our consumers. We serve our consumers first. So the first market that will get any product is the UAE. And then all of the rest of the Gulf, the GCC, the Levant, North Africa come at all basically the same timing.
Okay, great. So, James, let's talk about one of the topics that we've been discussing when it comes to companies in these times, which regards to liquidity. And to what extent have you altered maybe your expansion plans or your liquidity position to better fit the current circumstances around COVID-19? So were you planning to do any expansion and you decided to postpone it due to the circumstances and to kind of preserve cash?
It's a great question. At the beginning, we were concerned. We didn't know how long this would go and what would be the circumstances. So we did delay certain launches. Like we delayed our new entry into Pakistan with a joint venture. Uh-huh. But as the business developed and as we did a great job on controlling costs and we did a very good job in collections and we had some strong launches, we've now launched Pakistan. We basically brought it back on the table. And as of now, we have a very strong liquidity position. But we obviously watch all of our money and we protect the shareholders.
What kind of cost-cutting strategy are you working on? Or have you worked on and you expect to continue with it?
It's basically taking what we consider non-value-added costs out of the system. Now, if we go specifically to people, that's not a non-value-added cost. We take care of our people. We didn't cut one salary. We even gave bonuses and we gave raises to our people. Okay. And I told the organization that if we do have to cut salary, the first salary to be cut 100% is me. And then we'll see if we have to go any further than that. But we have never touched, our people are our most precious assets. So we did not touch any benefits. We, in fact, expanded our benefits.
Okay, so let's talk about how you view consumer behavior post-corona. Now, obviously, in the previous 6 months, we have witnessed a totally new consumer with new habits. Mm-hmm. To what extent do you believe that these new habits formed because of corona will continue to stay even after we're done with COVID-19 and a vaccine is found? To what extent do you think that you are dealing with a whole new consumer with new habits and new demands and new preferrals, maybe?
We believe, and I believe, that this will touch our generation forever. Mm-hmm. And the COVID will have an impact. My parents were born in 1915, and they grew up during the Spanish flu, and they were germaphobes. And I always used to, as a child, I never understood it because we had vaccines, and I never worried about germs, but they were always worried.
It's a different generation. You were from a different generation.
Right, I was different. I grew up in the generation of antibiotics and vaccines, and you didn't worry. They always worried. We're all going to worry now because we've learned that we are vulnerable and that new strains of viruses and bacteria can emerge. This will change us forever. And so the areas of disinfection, sanitization, wellness, and specifically immune system function is going to be with us for the next 50 to 100 years.
What is the importance of technology in your industry when it comes to these new habits and this new environment we're going to live in?
It's extremely important because there are emerging technologies like the Living Guard technology that we use on our masks that didn't exist. And so masks before Living Guard was all about filtration. Mm. Is it an N95? Is it an N99? all these designations, that's just filtration. That doesn't kill a germ. It just keeps it from coming in. with these new technologies, you actually can sterilize the air as it passes through the mask. And that changes the game completely. And so you're going to see major impacts of technology in terms of disinfection and germ protection.
So in regards to any expansion plans you have, you mentioned Pakistan. So any other expansion plans we expect to see, maybe not this year, but maybe 2021?
Yes, we're quite aggressive. We believe that recessionary times are the right time to sometimes be aggressive and to go into the market. We will be expanding many of our sterilizing products worldwide, including North America.
Thank you so much, James Michael Lafferty, CEO of Fine Hygienic Holding, for being with us today. That was quite an interesting time to talk about this industry in specific because of all the changes that we have witnessed in the last 6 months.
Absolutely, and thank you for having me. It's been an honor.
Thank you, sir. So, ladies and gentlemen, this is the end of CEO Talks for this episode. Next episode, we're going to have a new executive from a new industry. And of course, we're going to talk about the implications, opportunities, and challenges that COVID-19 has created over the past 6 or 7 months. See you next one. Bye-bye.